and welcome to this T4D version number 3. Now that T4D, I said was kind of tip for the day, or it's either you could call it thought for the day. And in this one, because it was such a good response to the chat I did about my playing with references and precision voltage references and what have you, I thought I'd just go a little more into the topic of metrology, which is the science or study of measurement. And in particular, obviously, the side that I'm going to be talking about is how that relates to electrical measurement. Just to go through some of the terms and words which are used, because it's quite fascinating when you get into certification and who holds the standard and how things are checked and all that kind of thing. So it's going to be quite a few bits and pieces that we cover off in this video. I'm also going to show you my start at a proof of concept ultimate digital multimeter calibration check, which I've started putting together. It is rough, it's a proof of concept, but I think it holds a few principles which might work well for kind of the ultimate bench multimeter check device, which I'd like to have. So we're actually going to do some calibration on this during the video as well and go through a few bits and pieces. But just a few, a few words around this kind of open conversation video insert that I've decided to have. For one, as I said, it's kind of a free, easy talk session for me to kind of talk about a topic which may be of interest to folks. As I've previously said, these videos are clearly denoted, i.e. T4D, so that if this kind of open conversation is going to bore you, then you know it's easy to skip them because you can see them. Another note, to make it easier perhaps for folks who want to follow this, and if they're longer, is there are options to download videos off YouTube. I'm going to put a link in the details below where there's, let's say, an add-on to Firefox, which will then allow you to download YouTube videos. And that might make it easier for folks. I know, like for instance, in South Africa, bandwidth's very bad. So when you buffer, it takes an age to buffer YouTube videos if you've got low bandwidth. And you can then often, if you leave them buffering, if you leave them too long, they may lose track of where they are and you just lose everything. So it's far easier just to download the video and view it offline. I'd ask though, if you are going to do that option, please still come back to the YouTube video and rate it, because again, that really helps what I do. The other option is, I know there are certain players where you can actually play a video at, let's say, 1.5 or even twice the speed. Twice, I might have that wrong, but certainly 1.5 times the speed, and it still retains the kind of tone of the person speaking, so that the tone pitch isn't put out, and that can help kind of get through a video like this. I just put it out there just so that it makes it easier for those of you who kind of want to follow this, but time may be a bit of an issue. Right, so let's get stuck in and have a quick close look at what I've put together, and then we'll kind of talk about the terminology and what have you related to measurement. Okay, so let's just look at what I have here. Perhaps the easiest thing to start off with is the little reference check which I've put together in order to check resistance. So as you'll have noted, when I've done my kind of checks with Doug's voltage standard DMM check, it gets very clumsy trying to hook onto the small resistors which are placed on here. And so hooking onto them is an issue. There's losses in the leads as well, which needs to be compensated for. So it makes it a bit fidgety for me when I'm actually doing those checks. So what I decided to do, as I showed in the previous video, I went out and bought some precision resistors. Now, when I say precision resistors, what we're going to do a check. These are metal oxide, as I recall, but their tolerance, as opposed to a normal resistor, which we're also going to do a check against, a normal resistor, a quarter watt, or whatever wattage, is probably around 1% of its value. So the tolerance in terms of how close to its value it can be is around 1%. These are 0.1%. Now, these actually potentially are slightly better than the ones which are provided on my digital multimeter check. The tolerance of these is also 0.1%, but in terms of the temperature coefficient, these are rated at 15 parts per million, and the ones on my digital multimeter check are rated at 25 parts per million. Now that terminology, 25 parts per million, is in essence just a finer, more granular way of representing, like for instance, a percentage. Like percentage is 1 in 100, where if you're talking about parts per million, well then you've got in essence a million. It's far more granular to use that terminology, and often when you get to these small tolerances, that's what they kind of refer to. Now, does that tolerance difference make any difference in terms of the temperature coefficient in, let's say, my lab, where I want to be able to work between, let's say, 15 degrees Celsius and maybe 35 degrees Celsius? Now, that's quite a wide band, but potentially in winter it could get down to that temperature, and in summer. So I want to kind of make sure that my references aren't adversely affected by that temperature range in my little lab here. So I don't know, maybe it comes into it, maybe it doesn't. And that's something, one of the checks down the line, which I'd like to play with and see how well that works. So all I've done here, and this is very rough. When I say rough, can you believe, when I was throwing this together, I actually did measure, put a mark to line, map this all out. But as you can see, when I was drilling the holes, it went slightly off. But it doesn't matter. This is a proof of concept. It's a test. Ultimately, if I do put a box together like this to do my reference checks, I realize it's going to be bigger. So let me just tell you what ultimately I'm hoping this is going to grow to. For one, this is going to be, will be a resistance check, which I'll show you how it works now. I could then have another banana socket to do a diode test. One with an LED, one with a frequency check, one with the voltage references, maybe one with a capacitor check. So it could turn out to be quite a big little surface area to contain all those checks. Also, in terms of being kind of a really a good little device, I'd probably power it from 8 or 10 1.5 volt lithium AA batteries. Lithium batteries are probably going to last far better than the 9 volts. The kind of runtime, the storage capacity is far higher. They're lightweight, and I say, yeah, their shelf life should be better. So that would be my plan. Also, if I really get into it, what I'd like to have is that I would, let's say, for instance, I've got a 10 volt reference in here, just like I was playing with the other day up here. This little fellow, I would like to know that when I power this on, that my reference checks itself against another reference to see if it's gone out of calibration. And that may sound crazy, and Martin, why on earth would you want to do that? But it's just something I'd like to have. I don't think for the most part most people need that, but when you start getting up to the more scientific equipment, like the big 8.5-digit HP Agilent digital multimeters, they actually have internal references which they check themselves against when you power them up. It's that kind of, when you get down to that level of granularity and what have you, it gets critical. But is one reference just enough? What happens if my kind of prime reference goes out and the one I'm checking against is drifting in the same direction? Well, then perhaps I need another reference, so that when I switch this on, my prime check does a reference check against one reference and another one. And it could then either tell, oh, maybe one of my check references is going out, or hang on, I'm out from both of these, I must be out, light up a red LED. Crazy idea, but there you go. Okay, so let's get down to what I've got so far and what we're going to calibrate. Now, in essence, what I'm going to have is precision resistors for across the resistance range. So I can check from several ohms to 1K, 10K, 100K, and kind of, I want a few ranges in between the normal multimeter ranges. So I just don't have one resistance range per, or one resistor per range in essence. Now, all I've got so far, as I say, I'm still waiting on things to arrive, is just the two. And as I recall, let me check, I've got a 255 ohm and a 255K resistor. So all I've done is just carefully soldered them in the back of these connectors over here. So basically, obviously you don't have the, they're soldered in here. They're obviously tucked out of harm's way when they're inside the box. Then I have gone and found the best banana connectors that I could at my local electronics shop. I don't think they're great. I was actually ideally hoping to find some gold-plated ones, but I couldn't find them, but these will do for now. I did what I have gone and done is made up a set of leads, which I said I would do. So basically, these leads fundamentally form part of this calibration unit because I'll be calibrating up to the tips where these go into the multimeter. So these will become part of the reference so that I don't have to cater for losses. Now, as you'll see, I've actually done a measurement with these already. And even just preparing these leads has made a huge difference. So what have I done here? I found these banana connectors, which they're gold in color, so I'm assuming they are gold plated, which might make obviously their level of resistance lower than the norm, or at least it's going to help with the contact when they go into the sockets. Two, I've got silicone leads here, but these are very thick. They are, let me just hold the one up for you. These are 2.5 millimeters squared. So these have got a far greater surface area of conductors inside. They are rated. They have got a SABS stamp on here. Now this is a South African Bureau of Standards. So they've certainly been tested at some level, and by all accounts, when I show you the resistance of these now compared to a normal set of multimeter leads, you'll see that even just doing this has made a difference. So let's jump in and actually do that at the moment so we can see how this works. Right, so you have to excuse the kind of confined camera work here, but it just makes it easier for viewing all these multimeters at once. Now what I've got a set of Fluke test leads attached to my Fluke 287. These are silicon leads, and I've got the crocodile clips on here so that I can connect them together and we can have a look at the resistance across the leads. So there you can see, if we just leave it for a moment, we're sitting at 0.12 ohms. Now, if we have a look at the level that the digital multimeter check goes to on the 1K, and my one has been measured by Doug to 999.3. So it goes down to certainly one decimal place of an ohm, and I would certainly at least like to be able to have a reference that's got that level of resolution and accuracy. So certainly if you're sitting with 0.12 loss across your leads, that really potentially can throw things out, and it's always a ball ache having to delta or zero that out. So let's try the other leads. I'll connect those up quickly. So here we go. I've got my own made up leads, which I say are kind of shorter in length. They've got thicker conductor in them, got nice little gold tip banana clips on them. And what I'm going to do, okay, there you can see as I touch these, I'm getting a reading. I just want to make sure we've got no funnies going on. But if I let them loose, we're certainly got the right reading on the Fluke. I'm going to clip them into each other. And that's a nice solid connection in there. And what do we get? 0.02. So I must say, I'm very happy with that result. I mean, that's almost negligible. But seeing as I'm going through this exercise and ball hairs are ball hairs, I will, when I calibrate, we're going to cater for these leads and even that small difference or loss or resistance in the leads themselves. So as I said, so we calibrate to the tips. Right, so just before I go and connect up to the two references I've got on here, I just want you to note the very valuable addition on this of those wonderful little pads that Eve sent me. And it seems silly, but this little box, as you can imagine, would be slipping across surfaces or skidding across surfaces, and these certainly make a difference. It means it sits there and it's fast, it doesn't move. Right, so let's switch on the backlight of the 287. And the way I've kind of my design of this is basically I have the one common point so that when I'm doing a check, I'm not moving two leads in and out. In essence, I'm just moving one because the resistors will all have a common connection. I have literally just the two references, so I've plugged that in. Remember, this is supposed to be a 255 ohm. And that basically also compensating, remember, is about what 0.2 out. That is very close. Very close indeed. It's certainly within the spec in terms of if I was going to the first digit after the comma. Bearing in mind that now we don't know the kind of the accuracy. I don't know off the top of my head the how inaccurate my 287 can be. So we're going to do a reference check across all of these. We're in essence going to average those. The more I'm going to do, I will weight whichever one of my multimeters is the closest to the unknown reference, the best known reference I have, which is obviously this reference which Doug did on his fancy 8.5 digit. I'll weight that more heavily if the others are way off. Right, so let's go through them. So the first check there is 25493. I'm going to note that and write it down. And this is the 255K, and there we're at 254.91. And again, that seems fairly close to me. Okay, now it's the turn of the Agilent, and just for fun as well, I'm not going to use its smart resistance feature. I'm just going to use a standard resistance feature. I've got the leads together, and again, in essence, ball hairs. This is going down to three places, which is quite nice. I have also noted where I'm making notes over here. I have noted the temperature in the room at the moment on my normal thermometer, not on what the Agilent's reading at 18.3. But let's go and do the other checks now. So we plonk into the common and go into the 255. Right. So we'll just let that settle for a while. I'm going to call that 25496. Let's go into the other one. I'm going to call that 25485. Right, we're now onto the Brymen. I've connected the leads just for fun again, and again, in essence, very low resistance in the leads measured on the Brymen. I'm going to go plonk the common in. Two five four nine four. Let's do the next one. Two five 4.77. Okay, if we have a look at the metrics, it's calling the leads zero. I'm going to note that as 255.13. I'll note that as 254.89. Okay, and we'll include the Isotec as well in this test, and leads together, it's reading zero, and this is in the 255 ohm. This one, by all accounts, once it's settled, we'll see what we'll note it as. I'm going to note that as it is jumping to 99 as well as 25498. Okay, now we've got it in the 255k range. And I'm going to note that as 254, interesting, swinging around a bit there. Can't account for why it's doing that. I'm just going to note it as 25480. Let's try and compensate for that. Right, I'm not going to bore you with going through all of these, but as I said, what I'm going to do, I'm going to give more weighting to the multimeter that has the closest reading to the reference I have from Doug. So what I've got my leads, I've got these croc clips attached now. I'm going to start off with a fluke. So what I am going to do across all of these is I am going to double check again the loss. And by all accounts, again, that's kind of very small. And then I'm going to clip it onto, so this is the 1K. And then I'm going to note all those measurements and see which is the closest to see if one of the multimeters, in essence, would be weighted heavier because it's closer to the reference, known reference that I have. Okay, so let's have a quick look at these results. And those are the final results from all the multimeters. I also noted what they were in accordance, obviously, to the reference. You'll note that the references 999.3, and in that case the fluke was certainly close. It was flickering between 0.3 and 0.4. The Brian was what, going 3 and 4 as well. The metrics had another decimal place and it was measuring spot on 4.7, and then the Isotech was going 0.12, so they're all, must say, not too far off. That necessary doesn't reflect how close they were in these figures over here, but none of them were right off the mark. So what I've chosen to do is use all the results, I've averaged them, and it's come out to three decimal places. I'm going to retain that, and then on here, as you can see, what I've done, I've noted this is calibration 0001, it's the 5th of May 2012, the temperature of the room at the time, and then I've noted that obviously that's a 255K, but its averaged value across all those multimeters was 254.842, and then the lower resistance one of 255 ohm came to 255.988. So we'll again measure this with the when I get the 6.5 digit. It's also fascinating to note, could I repeat that? If I repeated all those measurements again, what would the repeatability be like? So let's start discussing some of those terms soon. But before we do that, let's have a quick close look at what a kind of precision resistor versus a standard resistor in terms of how close they are on the value. We've already seen what these are like, but let's just test these as well. Okay, so here we go. For that bit of fun, I said we'd literally just do a comparison between normal resistors and precision resistors. Now, again, so this is something interesting, again, a topic I'll bring up in terms of uncertainty. And the term uncertainty when you're taking measurements or calibration is kind of the effect that the procedure or your environment can have on your resultant reading. Like, for instance, if I'm holding these, and can you see how the meter is being affected? And that's obviously because there are two screw contact points here. So procedurally, I'm doing something wrong, which can affect the outcome. And once you get down to the finer art of taking measurement, you have to account for uncertainty. Okay, so I've got my hands as far off the ends as possible. And the interesting thing is here, these are 270K. I was hoping to try and get resistors which were as close to the ones that I had but in the shop, but they didn't unfortunately have them. So these are 1% tolerance. Now if you work out 1% tolerance on 270K, that'd be 2.7K. And these seem a long way off, so I'm going to just quickly flick through them and see if we get any closer to the mark. Okay, so I stepped out and actually did a bit of checking, just because when I started measuring these, the values were all over the place, and that kind of 1% didn't make sense. So I went and checked the resistor color codes, which I haven't done for a long time. And these are not 1% as I was told when I bought them. It's got a gold band, which means it's 5%. So understandably, they're going to be potentially all over the chart. So yeah, it's something to realize. If you want a precise resistor, then you need to carefully understand what your application, the color code is, and make sure you get what you want. So certainly what I purchased online at RS Components, these ones certainly are very close within spec. You do get a slightly tighter tolerance. I think you get a slightly better one than this. I must actually double check, but certainly these I'm happy with as a reference. So one interesting thing that I did note, and I need to investigate, temperature coefficient, it seems like they talk about in terms of failure rate, the ones at 25 parts per million are less prone to failure than the ones at 15. I'm not sure about that. It's something I've just read now, but it's something that I'll investigate for the future. Okay, so before we get into that terminology, let's just recap a few things about accuracy and resolution. Now, accuracy is kind of the idea of how precise you can to a particular reading or measurement you can get, your precision. And the resolution is how fine or how granular you can show a certain reading to a number of decimal places and what have you. Now, I've got two multimeters here. I've got this Breitman and I've got my Fluke 287. My Fluke 287 is a 50,000 count multimeter, which means it can show at, let's say, 50 volts, to make it straightforward, it can show that down to 3 decimal places. Okay. My Breitman, on the other hand, is a 500,000 count, and it can show 50 volts down to 4 decimal places. However, the Fluke, in terms of its quoted accuracy, is more accurate than the Breitman, slightly, just slightly. So is it, but that means that basically the Breitman has got 10 times the resolution, and because its accuracy is either the same or slightly less than the Fluke's, those last decimal places, if you do the calculations, you are going to have a variance on the same number of more decimal places than you are the Fluke. So you certainly can't show anything more accurately on this Breitman, even though it's got higher resolution. So does that higher resolution go to waste? And the answer is no, because sometimes you don't need to have absolute accuracy. You may want a relative reading. And let me try and put that in perspective. You could be measuring a 1-volt battery or 1.5-volt battery being charged by a solar cell. You're not particularly interested in the exact measurement, but you want to understand whether it's actually gaining voltage or losing voltage. And unless you have high resolution, you might not be able to see that. And that's where this Breitman is really handy, because that resolution allows me to see the digits really low down changing long before my Fluke can. Okay, so you don't always have to have that accuracy. Now, another thing I want to bring up when kind of talking about those bits and pieces is it can be very confusing, and I often get caught off guard by the way different manufacturers quote their accuracy and resolution, particularly the accuracy. Some manufacturers will say, once you've got a reading, you take a certain percentage of the reading, plus or minus so many least significant digits. Some will say take a percentage of the reading and then add a percentage of the range. Some will say just take a percentage of the full scale range. And then some, the more scientific equipment, will be expressed as parts per million. So it's something you need to note if you are looking at these bits and figures, because I can often get caught off guard with that and make an incorrect judgment in terms of what might have the better accuracy. And when it gets down to the more scientific bit, equipment, like for instance the 6.5, 7.5, 8.5 digit multimeters, there you have to take in they will give you accuracy figures according to the last time you've had the meter calibrated. So that could be within a 24-hour period, because in some cases in a very high-tech lab they may be taking readings where they need the best accuracy reading, and the best accuracy reading on that particular meter may only be within valid but for a 24-hour period. Then you get a 90-day period and perhaps a year period, and those have to be taken into account. Plus then you have to add, if you're outside a certain temperature range, you need to add a certain value on for being outside that temperature range. Now, if I send my Fluke away to be calibrated, how do I know that it's actually been calibrated accurately? In theory, hopefully it would come back with a certificate, a calibration certificate, stating all the calibration figures. But how do I know that the place I sent it to, that their equipment is accurately calibrated? And here we come down to something called traceability. And traceability basically is a hierarchy going up to a place which maintains the known standard for that measurement. So like for instance, you can go to, and I think if I remember correctly, there's a standards organization in France which hold the measurement for a meter. It's literally a measure held in special conditions so that, you know, you don't get any shrinkage or expansion due to temperature, and it's made out of a special metal to try and compensate for that. And they also hold a kilogram, the kilogram mass. And those are actual physically there, and those are held as the global standard to which all other measurements are held. Now, I say that in inverted commas. Obviously, different countries and everywhere have gone and adopted, got their own exact measurements that they adopt to. Most countries have their own bodies or organizations which look after measurement standards for the country. In the States, it's known as the National Institute for Standards and Technology, NIST. In South Africa, there is SANSA. And so locally you can go within your country and they will hold a standard to which other people should work to within the country. It's generally an ISO 9000 standard, an international organization standard which they try and adhere to. So let's say I send my Fluke off to a company to be calibrated. In theory, if it's got traceability, and this is something that's critical for obviously labs and educational institutions, if they are concerned about their calibration, if they just send it to Joe Blogs down the road, they don't know whether his stuff's calibrated. So they send it off to somewhere where there's traceability, and then that group of people with their equipment would need to be calibrated or certified by, let's say, a NIST organization that's got, or by NIST themselves. And NIST themselves would have to then, up the tree, have a reference or something which is calibrated to the actual known standard. So there's a hierarchy so that things don't get lost. So there is, in essence, traceability allows you to trace your calibration all the way up the tree to the actual global known standard. Obviously, things can go wrong along the way, but that is traceability. Now, in theory, one could say that if that reference, what happens if that globally known reference goes off or is wrong? Then does everything underneath collapse? And no, as long as there is proper record keeping, everyone within the tree, because people can obviously, within a country or organizations, can cross-reference each of their own references as long as they've kept documentation to see if they're correct. And by building up that history, you're not relying on that single source reference because you now have known documented references down the tree, the hierarchy tree. So that's traceability. As I said, uncertainty, there's an uncertainty factor in terms of when calibration or measurements are taken, and human procedural issues can affect things, like you see with the way I was handling the leads doing a measurement. That could obviously affect things, and people put values down to that uncertainty. It really is a fascinating science in terms of those bits and pieces. Now, someone jokingly left a comment after I posted the initial video, saying that, well, they could just put a nice rubber anti-slip on their 9-volt battery, and that could act as their reference, their stable reference source. And in theory, if you measured this battery to several decimal places, could you use it as a reference? And conceivably, for a short time period, you could. And I say short time period because that's what I got. I referred to this, and I didn't state exactly what, but I actually asked someone who did a review of a Tektronix 6.5-digit multimeter on YouTube. I asked them to measure, to see if they could measure the voltage drop or loss of a battery that isn't under load. And I actually asked Doug to do the same on his 8.5-digit. And of course, potentially there, the results can be skewed, because even connecting your 9-volt battery up to a multimeter, when you're measuring voltage, in theory, this isn't part of the circuit. Your multimeter has high impedance, but you really do need a very high impedance on your multimeter so that there isn't a voltage drop or loss on the battery that you're measuring or the source that you're measuring. But even there, even on a 6.5-digit multimeter with high impedance, there you can actually measure the slow drop in voltage of a 9-volt battery over a couple of hours. Talk about splitting bull hairs, but there you go. So even your 9.5-volt battery sitting on the shelf potentially can't be used as a voltage reference. Okay, then someone also made a comment about that basically a 6.5-digit multimeter that, like I'm getting the Fluke 8846, was perhaps overkill, and that a 5.5-digit would do. He kind of quoted that the HP 3478A, which is an old classic HP bench multimeter. It's 5.5-digit, it's got good accuracy, it's got a lovely crisp liquid crystal display, and I personally, after looking at the specs of them and seeing them, would love to own them. You can buy them on eBay. If anyone wants to donate one, I would fall over backwards. If you could buy one and send one to me, I'd review it and certainly give credit to you. It'd be a lovely device to have in my pack of multimeters. But basically, as I said, the problem is that even with those higher count and higher digit multimeters, you need to almost have 10 times the accuracy and resolution to measure a certain reference. So if I put that in perspective, my Fluke 287 can measure, as I said, 50 volts to 3 decimal places, but with its accuracy figures, and off the top of my head, It's about 0.025, I think, for that range. I stand to be corrected, but I've noted the variance basically that at 50 volts to 3 decimal places, the last 2 decimal places can potentially be taken up with a variance in its accuracy. So, like, it could be by plus 50.014 for an exact reading of 50.000. So if you knew you had a precision 50 volt source of 50.000, this could read 50.014. So in essence, it's absolute, what I would define as then its absolute accuracy would only be to one decimal place for 50 volts, 50.0, because you'd know for its accuracy that's quoted, and let's say even temperature and lack of calibration for a year or what have you, that at least to 50.0 it would be accurate, that last decimal point. Now, to have a reference to check that, as an example, the Fluke 8846 can measure 50 volts down to 4 decimal places, but again, it's got 10 times the resolution. It has 10 times, about 10 times the accuracy as well. But that means that at that 50 volts down to 4 decimal places, it could read 50.0025. Okay, so still, its last two least significant digits can have a variance on them. So in essence, you could own, if you want to know, understand its absolute accuracy and precision that you could measure something to, it would be 50.00, which would be 10 times in essence what this is. And that's where, for me, having that 6.5 digit, I kind of, if I want to have a good reference so I can measure things like this 50,000 count, because if I had an accurate 500,000 count, that 6.5 digit wouldn't do. But at least for this range of multimeters, that 6.5 digits bench multimeter does its job. Okay, to wrap it up, I hope that was a very high level basic overview of kind of the what can be involved in measurement and calibration and what have you. Again, I'm not an expert in this area. I find it fascinating. So I hope just that little chat about those bits and pieces might give you an idea of how complex and how interesting the whole science of measurement is. Hopefully, if you really find it interesting, go off and do some research. I mean, that's what I'm kind of doing at the moment, is digging around on the internet to find out as much as I can myself. Having that kind of precision in the world may seem silly at times, but I can tell you on a daily basis, and there are probably some very big accidents which you could refer to, which have been caused due to inaccurate measurement and people making mistakes or instrumentation not being calibrated correctly. I know, for instance, like there's a nuclear power station just outside Cape Town. It's across the bay, and they won't allow any measurement equipment to into that facility that hasn't got a recent certificate of calibration that's got traceability. So you can't go have gone down to Joe Blogs down the road. They want to see traceability to a known standard. Why? Because in a nuclear power station, if you get things wrong, potentially things blow up, people die. So that's the worst, that's the extreme case, is that people's lives and property, there are bridges which have been known to have collapsed because of people have even mixed up metric and non-metric measurement standards when converting things and what have you. So measurement can be critical, and it's fascinating understanding all the bits and pieces along the way. Now, I will certainly pursue a bit more on my little ultimate calibration device. As soon as I start getting the other references which are coming in, I'll set them up and we'll start doing experiments in terms of understanding how they react to a temperature range, how they handle being handled roughly, what happens if you start dropping the voltage. I'm also looking for, and again, what you can do, you can jump onto my forum, and if there isn't a specific forum topic or what have you there that I need to open, I can do that. But it'd be interesting to understand, I'm keen to know, first of all, are there any of you out there with 5.5, 6.5 count or more equipment who could enlighten, tell us about it, tell us what your calibration experience has been like, how well they work, what have you. I'd be keen to know. I'd be keen to know what you kind of, whether you've managed to pick up a kit like that cheaply on eBay and whether it has worked. I'd also be keen to know if you've had any bad experiences due to your instrumentation being out of calibration or what have you. So thanks very much if you managed to get through to the end of this video. As I said, I will be posting more as I get information. Also on the forum, the one thing I haven't got sorted yet is a current reference. I'm not sure how Doug does his 1 milliamp current reference. I've started doing some research, but if you have any ideas, then again, jump onto the forum and post them. I'm intrigued to get a circuit which has got, can act as a good current reference. And ideally, I would like also a better range. Rather than just 1 milliamp, being able to have several current ranges, let's say like a half an amp, 100 milliamp, 10 milliamp, 1 milliamp. Because that is something I'd obviously like to have in my standard as well. Also, there was a question about measuring capacitors by one of the users across, he was reckoned his Agilent was playing up. So I've gone and bought a mix of capacitors. It's something that I've not really done before. So I'll be posting a video soon where I do a test across several of my multimeters to see the varying results which the capacitors come up with, and to see if my Agilent also has a problem with measuring capacitors. Anyway, thanks very much for watching. Please, if you think other people may gain value from this kind of video, then certainly do share it. If you gain any value, because it certainly does help me progress what I do, please give it a thumbs up, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.